situations that we have that he plans with job creation, the economic development piece, the education, transportation, healthcare, youth, and senior citizens, which are all in jeopardy. Okay, this is something that he's going to be discussing on what he plans to do in our district. And I give him the full support of whatever decision he makes to make sure that we make sure that these positions and these topics are taken care of. Once again, I want to introduce to you our Senator, Pedro Espada.
Thank you so very much. If you would indulge me, con su permiso, a ver si, si abrimos con una oración. May we ask upon you to launch us into this mighty effort with a prayer, my good friend, Reverendo.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator. You're always, always putting God first, and that's very important. Let us just pray. Father God, we just want to thank you this evening. As we come together, Lord, and we discuss everything in the community, we discuss the issues and the problems, Lord. Lord, we ask you that you may give us the wisdom, the knowledge, and the know-how, Lord. Give the Senator the ability, Lord, and the wisdom to cope with every issue, every problem, and that we may go back to the Senate, Lord, and do what we have to do, Lord, and we can just help our community that are hurting, that are going through so much, Lord. We ask you this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. Now we're ready, right? Now we're ready. Indeed, it is a pleasure to be here and to provide directly a report from the New York State Senate, from the office of the Majority Leader of the Senate, yours truly. We thank our staff. You'll get to meet each and every one of them and their critical roles in what we do, not only in this community, but up in Albany, where we legislate and we lead. I think the most important thing to do right now is, as you say, is to continue to focus on what we were elected to do, and that is represent this community. And what we've been fighting for all of our lifetime but finally got an opportunity to do was to bring one of the most powerful offices in the New York State Senate, the office of the Majority Leader, to the 33rd State Senate District. And there are clearly forces. There are clear, defined forces of resistance that will do anything to strip away this opportunity from all of us. Pero yo sé, por cierto, que con la ayuda de Dios y también con el poder de la comunidad, vamos a mantener nuestro enfoque y nuestro poder. We know that through God's guidance and strength, we will maintain our strength, our focus, and no one will be able to take away this prize of real empowerment for our community belongs to you. I just happen to be privileged to be your agent, and I thank you for that opportunity. Let's get right to it in terms of the budget. We have, as you know, a constitutional obligation to present a budget that belongs first and foremost to the governor of the state of New York. And on January, he presented a budget. A budget that, whether we agree with it or not, deals with, in his mind, deals with the issues that affect not only New York State, but to be honest with you, all of the states in America are going through a very difficult time. And in fact, this is a global financial crisis. But dealing with New York, and to keep that in focus for the moment, we have a $9 billion deficit. More expenses than revenue by $9 billion this year. And if we go out into the out years, we're talking about $20 billion, $30 billion. In other words, numbers that would stagger the most mighty economies in the world, including these days China as well. So these are issues that don't belong in the lap of any one leader, and the state Democratic leaders, Senator Sampson, myself, Malcolm Smith, and others, we've been working very closely together to put forth a budget that's clearly not going to be on time because it was supposed to be adopted April 1. But a budget that features economic development. Why are we poor? We are poor because we haven't had the opportunity in our communities to truly develop a private economy, economic development, jobs in our community. Many of us work for hospitals, for government. We're teachers, we're firefighters. But we also have one of the biggest distinctions, which we have to do away with, which is we have the highest unemployment rate in the state of New York, right here in the Bronx. And so job creation, economic development, is one of the really key centerpieces of this budget and the majority leader's office. And what we hope to do with that is that we have to create a way in which all of us walk around with our pocket full of dreams. And the truth of the matter is that if you talk to people in our community, as I have, and when we talk to Angel and he wants to develop a business improvement district, and he wants to develop the retail, what people call mom and pop stores in this community, when he wants to develop a parking garage to allow real commerce to take hold, we're listening. And we're not only listening, we're going to invest in those dreams, and we have started to do that, and we're going to continue to do that, because you're on the right track. You have that idea. And all of the business improvement districts, and we're blessed to have very many of them, in Fordham, in Kingsbridge, in other areas of our community, where people have real plans. They've held on to those plans for a long time without having the ability to actually get the money, the investment in those dreams. And we're working very closely. In fact, tomorrow, we're having a task force that we created on economic development, on job creation, to really develop the plans for this community that would include bringing the armory. We're not going to say 3,000 jobs, go home, goodbye. No. We're going to have a plan there so that we have construction jobs, so that we have jobs in our community of people that have no skills. Let's be clear. We have had for a generation tremendous dropout rates in our community. We have people, God bless them, that come from other countries that perhaps can't speak the English language as well as their children will speak it. But we can't write off anybody. We have to include everybody. And what we're doing with the plans there is to make sure that we have people in our community trained to be able to do the kind of work that is necessary, so that if you happen to not have a high school diploma or a college degree, we're not going to say goodbye, we don't need you, this economy is too good for you. We're going to deal with weatherization programs. We're going to bring programs into our community that will teach our children and our grandchildren the skill sets to be able to have alternative energy sources take hold, whether that's solar energy, whether that's weatherizing the windows in apartments, whether that's modernizing them, whether that's in construction jobs, as plumbers, as electricians. We are going to move to create those kinds of opportunities for people that have been written off by this economy. But we're also clear about one other thing, an investment in education. You've heard these fights go on. People will be throwing out leaflets all over the place about charter schools versus public schools. And let me be very clear, as a former teacher myself, I taught, in fact, in this district, in elementary school, and I taught in high school as a social studies teacher. Public school is public school. We will always, always protect a public school education. It is a fundamental right in a democracy to have that. And so a million or so children in our New York City public school system must have not just the opportunity to go to school, but real investment so that they can have a real 21st century education. Now, what do we mean about that? We have this big fight these days where certain folks want to come into the community and develop charter schools. And they have developed models that work and other models that don't work. But the big fight is that over 40,000 children are on a waiting list that want to go to charter schools. And as your senator, I have taken the following position. I do not think that anybody owns a monopoly over our children's education. If there are faith-based organizations right on Jerome Avenue and what's my good friend Reverend Rivera? 170th and Jerome. Foreign language students. He has developed a charter school there that is a model for the state, where he has taken children who are unable to speak English, and not only do they learn the dominant English language, they preserve their own native language, and they are among the tops in terms of math and reading achievement in the state of New York, and that's happening right here in this Senate district. And so we will not say no to those kinds of opportunities, but we do have some problems. We have some problems with certain charter schools that have not admitted foreign language students into their recruitment of students. We have other students that have learning disabilities that have not been able to acquire a seat in a charter school. So it is fundamentally unfair to claim that you have the right formula for educational achievement when you're saying, well, if you happen to have a foreign language as your dominant language, you can't get in. If you happen to be a special needs child, you can't get in. In other words, cherry picking the best of the students, giving them an opportunity to succeed, is not the formula for success. So we're going to deal with that. But I am for charter schools. I am for the because charter schools are public schools. They are funded with public dollars. And there are enough opportunities, I believe, to be able to give those 40,000 children that are on a waiting list to get into a charter school an opportunity to have that kind of education. At the same time, we cannot turn back the fact that 99% of the children don't attend charter schools. They attend regular schools. And part of what we want to do at the Armory is to have more educational opportunities. In other words, new schools at the Armory for our children, particularly at the elementary and junior high school level. So that will be part of our economic development at the Armory, because education is the number one economic development tool that we have as a community. And I'm going to take some heat for it. You're going to get some stuff in the mail about Espada's anti-student and what have you. We just want to be clear of where we stand. And I came from Puerto Rico when I was 5 years old. I could not speak the English language. I was diagnosed as having a speech impediment. Maybe I still do, but we work on it. My speech impediment is that I talk too much and talk too much controversy. But the truth of it is that I was put in a corner, and it was what we call then English immersion. In other words, and that ugliness is still around, is that English only. And so we survive all that. But the truth of the matter is that there is nothing wrong with being multilingual. There is nothing wrong with being multicultural. In fact, that's our world. That's who you are. That's who we are. And that's what has to happen in the classroom, that we have to expose our children to the real world. The 21st century, where we have to know more than one language, we have to be aware of the cultures of other people and be unafraid of that. And so when you get this mail, understand that they're talking about me, the kid from Guamo, Puerto Rico, who couldn't speak English, who learned how to speak English, who maintained his cultural roots. I think we can do this as a community. Insist that charter schools and public education respect who we are and the value of our culture. Let me get to housing. I think 99% of the individual cases that we get in our offices, and we have two, as you know. We have the office that we have at Fordham Road, and we have the office on Bainbridge, and again, our staff will be here. We want you there. We want you to bring your concerns to us. But we know that many of you are very concerned about housing. And I want to spend some time on that. This housing budget must contain opportunities, greater opportunities for affordable housing. And we're working to get hundreds of millions of dollars in capital money to expand the development of affordable housing in our communities. What does that mean? What does that mean is that if you're only able to pay $600, $700, $800 a month, you are having a really hard time finding a good apartment where you can have that kind of money buy you a good living in an apartment that you will have your children be safe, that will be habitable, that you have good services in the summer, winter, and fall. And so we have to create some more because we simply don't have enough of those opportunities. And those millions of dollars in the budget that we're fighting for offer that. But let's just say that you're among the lucky and you have a good apartment and now you're just unable to afford to pay the rent. We have proposed a historic opportunity called a rent freeze. And it is a rent freeze that will keep your rent exactly where it's at today for 5 years. In other words, no increases in rent. In order for us to do that, we have to get a bill through the Senate and through the Assembly. And we're doing exactly that. We have proposed a bill that if you make $45,000 or less, $45,000 or less, and pay one-third of that towards rent, we will freeze your rent. We'll freeze your rent for 5 years. And I want to thank so many of you who came to Albany and helped deliver, in your own way, helped deliver that message up in Albany. Hundreds of people came up. Thank you, Bishop Rodriguez. Thank you. Thank so many of you who filled those buses and came up to Albany because we're being heard. And that would be a historic, historic achievement for not just the Bronx, for not our district, but for 600,000 people. 600,000 people in this city will finally get a direct assistance with their rent. It's never happened before. It's our legislation, and we thank you for supporting that. You know, we've talked about charter schools. We've talked about my rent freeze. We've talked about education. Let me just spend a moment talking about why it is so important to keep ourselves as majority leader. The majority leader's office is given a lot of discretionary funding. And we have been, and thanks to all of you who have been so great, we've been able to fund all of our senior centers, tens of thousands of dollars to our senior centers. Every single one of our public libraries has gotten money from us. We have an opportunity to give out, and we will. Whether I'm able to be at every graduation, I don't know. But we'll be able to start giving our savings bonds at every elementary graduation in the district so that those young kids who are graduating, we will be able to give them a savings bond. A savings bond of about $100. Now think about that. That's not going to buy a lot. But remember that kid from Cuamo, Puerto Rico, who couldn't speak English? There weren't that many people that told me when I was 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 that I was worth anything. There was every signal that I wasn't worthy. And what we want to tell not just the A students, because I was rarely that. What we want to tell is the C students, some of the D students, we want to tell them early, you're worthy, and you count, and we together will make something of your life. That's how I was able to survive being the head of my household at 14. That was how I was able to survive being homeless at 17. But I met a great woman, a young lady then. We've been married 37 years. She we have 10 grandchildren. And at 22 years of age, I was able to take that stability in my life that Fordham University degree and develop medical centers throughout the Bronx that on an annual basis provide over 100,000 visits to our children, to our families, and quality, affordable health care. And so I am no better than those 6 or 7 year old kids that are in those graduations. And this coming June, we're going to be there to tell them that they're worthy. Right? So you'll join me with that. Senior citizen centers, community centers, housing organizations, public schools, we are able to provide that direct money because we're in the majority as a senator in the New York State Senate. And we are going to pass a responsible, fair budget, and we are going to take to the streets this summer. And despite the distractions and accusations, we're going to stay focused on being the majority leader and going back to Albany, because we cannot transform ourselves in one election. And when I'm not there, we're going to make sure that after 2 or 3 times, somebody else is ready that you have chosen and not anybody else who thinks they can anoint our successor. The people will speak, the people know best, and we thank you for being here this evening. Thank you. We're going to take some questions.
The questions are going to be, we're going to be asking this young lady, Senator.
Monica.
We're going to be asking Monica to call out the names. Please, there's a mic in the back, so you can ask the senator any questions that you may have according to what he had just mentioned in these categories.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you for being here. Thank you. Deanna, could you please step to the mic in the back? Could you please step to the mic in the back? Okay.
Well, we have to pass the legislation that's been introduced. Let me introduce a couple of people that came down from Albany that are helping me on a daily basis and could perhaps not only present themselves but help me explain this critical legislation. Danielle and Kurt. Danielle, I know Kurt is shy. Why don't you come up for a second? A wonderful young lady at upstate New York who made it through law school and just a fine, fine addition to our team. So, please.
Good evening, everyone. And to answer your question, there is a program right now that is called SCRE and DRE, and essentially that freezes the rent for people who are disabled or are senior citizens. And there's also income qualifications as well, and they apply to this program with the city, and then their rent is frozen if they meet those requirements. So essentially, the senator's proposed legislation would be this, would be structured around those same around those two previous programs, but this program to people who don't have disabilities or people who are not senior citizens, and it only has that income requirement. Right now, those income requirements are $29,000 or less. You have to make only $29,000 or less to qualify for this program, and the senator's proposed legislation increases that to $45,000 or less. So,
at the time, we'll be able to give you more specific instruction on how to apply. But first, we have to make it real, and that means passing it through the Senate, which we are hoping to do in the next couple of weeks, and then the Assembly as well. But as with anything, it will be administered by the city, and it most likely will have an application process to verify, you know, income mostly. And it won't be based, as Daniel said, on age or on disability.
Right now, if you currently have a disability or you are a senior citizen, 65 or older, you 62 or older, I'm sorry, and you make $29,000 or less, you can apply for that program.
Jesus Rivera. Okay. Yeah, I know. Carlos Malve. He wants to know about school closings and people losing their jobs.
Okay, that's okay. We can deal with it. Those are all very good questions. In fact, you know, one of the really powerful things that we did last year was pass a school governance bill. And that new law requires that parents at the local level be notified about any school closures. You'll remember that Mr. Bloomberg has a lot of positive qualities, I'm sure, but one of the things that we in the state legislature were very concerned about was that he had too much unilateral power regarding school closures. And we passed a law that would require notice of that. And, in fact, he proposed several months ago to close 16 schools. And at least one or two were in my district. A number of people, mostly the United Federation of Teachers, sued and prevented those closures from happening because not enough community involvement and notice was provided. And so right now, the law is very strong on being able to give notification and to really get parental and community involvement on any proposed closure of a school. Now, there are issues that we'll continue to talk about in terms of what is a good performing school or a poor performing school, and those discussions must move forward. But right now, it is very difficult for the mayor to close the school without directly involving the community in that effort. In terms of jobs, you know, we've spoken somewhat about jobs and our economic development plans and invite you to join our economic development task force as we move to develop the Armory, as we move to develop the Stella Doro plant that went out of business. You know, and let me tell you something. Those kinds of opportunities are great because when I talk to people in our community like you, and they're saying, you know, well, did you eat Stella Doro cookies? I remember growing up in Mount Haven, yeah, we got them once in a while. Maybe they were a little stale. We couldn't afford to buy them fresh. We used to go to, what do you call that? What do you call that when you go to, you'll remember my brother there, when we went to the old Lincoln Hospital, Tasty Bread? It wasn't Tasty. The Day Old Bakery, thank you. It wasn't stale, it was good stuff. It wasn't Stella Doro. But we, you know, we sometimes we got a couple of dollars and we bought Stella Doro cookies and they were good. But they employed a lot of people. They employed over 100 some odd people and they lost their jobs. And they were good union jobs. But we have a model which says this. Maybe our community doesn't eat Stella Doro cookies, but we eat cookies. And some of us bake good cookies. And we are going to transform that building into a factory that will sell tres leches, that will sell cookies. Because you got to make something people are going to buy, right? And the fact of the matter is that we all buy cookies, we all bake cakes. And so the idea that Stella Doro moved to Ohio because some big company bought them out doesn't scare us. We're going to be able to bring forth a baking goods and other things because the community has changed. And the community that has jobs has economic buying power, purchasing power. And when you have a job and you have the ability to spend money, you will buy the cookies or the tres leches cake or whatever it is. Right? Valencia, in my generation, Valencia did quite well. I think we could have the modern-day Valencia in the West Bronx. So job creation we will, too, do.
Ginaldo Gendo, estoy en el proceso de disability. No tengo con quien pagar mi renta. ¿Qué puedo hacer en este momento?
Bueno, mi hermano, en estos momentos me gustaría, porque hay varios abogados aquí que forman parte de mi equipo. Quiero que usted hable con Alex Díaz y le vamos a brindar. Y María, que está ahí también. Por favor, at this point, can we just have our staff introduce themselves? Because María Rodríguez, introduce them, sir. Okay. We can have our folks know who they can get help from.
Well, good evening, everyone. Buenas noches. My name is Alex Diaz. Mi nombre es Alex Diaz. I'm the chief of staff for the senator. At this time, I want to introduce our staff that are here today. We obviously have Monica Coleman, our educational liaison, Maria Rodriguez, our deputy director of community affairs. We have the great Kurt Tucker, who handles our director of legislation.
That's him right there.
You've met Danielle. She works with Kurt. We also have Jerry Love, who's our housing assistant. We have Louis Johnson. I'm sorry, Louis. It happened to Michael Garvey the last time I had to do this. But Louis Johnson, who's part of our outreach team. We have Felipe De Los Santos, who's part of our internship program. We have Frank LaBoy, our press secretary, Frank. We have Gabriel De Jesus, who handles our community affairs at the office as well. Any constituents that might have any issues, he's part of our outreach team as well. We have Marzetta Harris, who's our director of community affairs. We have Sean Rosenberg. Sean handles our event planning. We have the great Ellison Elliott, who is our new special advisor towards economic affairs. We have, where's Richard? Richard Singh Paul, who's our counsel. We have Denisha, who is our administrative assistant. We have Jeanette Torres, who's in the front. She's our office assistant. Sigfredo Gonzalez. Sigfredo, most of you probably know, he's part of our outreach team. Who else? Ada Carella, who's also part of our outreach team. Angel Fernandez, who's sitting down, I didn't see her, but she's also part of our outreach team. These individuals are here for you. The senator is here to answer some of your questions, but we're also here to handle some of your issues. We want to make sure that at the conclusion of the question and answers, if you have any particular issues, any items that you're in your neighborhood, or anything that you need some assistance with, this is the team that's here to do it. These folks have various points of expertise. They're here to serve our community, and we're going to serve it well. So with that, I'm passing back over to our majority leader. The guy with the cowboy hat, Michael Garvey, who's part of our outreach team. Okay.
Esteban Macias, is it possible to add to your proposal the elimination of air conditioner law? It is disrespectful, and some landlords use dirty ways to impose it.
Yes, please.
Private building can match what the housing used to do. The housing, now they are charging about $15 or $18 per month for the air conditioner. But the housing pays for the electricity. And this law in the private building for using the window where to put, because there is no other place to put the air conditioner, they charge $5 for each air conditioner they use to the house. The law is given, I think I have an expression. Cruelly done, it's a disrespect to the people, because the law is, if you don't want to pay, you have to pay it even. If you take the air conditioning, no, still you have to pay the $5. Come on. So, and if you want to move the air conditioner, you have to ask the landlord permission to move the air conditioner from the window. Who owns
the air conditioner. The landlord, or I pay for it.
Yeah,
no, so it's stupid. It made me sick. Plus, the law also say that the landlord have some time for new air conditioner or new tenants to charge for the air conditioner. But it's so tricky, you know, it's say, but after several months or some time, is the landlord doesn't charge you, he lose the opportunity to do it. So how long is the specific time? 3 months, 4 months, 1 year? And this guy, when he put the charges, I was living 4.5 years in that building. And despite that, yeah, and I wrote him a letter. He said, you forgot that I have been here for 4.5 years. You are charging me. You cannot do that. I am not going to pay you. But the guy insists, and he knew so many tricky, they take pictures, they do some pressure, and there are some old, very old ladies, sick people, who has resigned to use the air conditioner because they can't afford to pay $5 or $10 extra dollars. And that's the reason I am
good point.
Asking.
Good point. You know, some of the best legislation,
efforts like what you've taken on. And I think we should all give him a hand because he's a fighter. Yeah, and what you're asking government to do is to help fix it. Let me put you in touch with Kurt and Danielle. We get together what the law is, specific law, and we'll seek to change that. All right, so that we'll work with you on that. Thank you for that, and thank you for fighting when you do.
Diana Acevedo, how soon is rent going to be frozen?
Well, that's exactly the point. This is one of those situations where in the next 2 weeks, we are going to put it on our housing committee agenda up in Albany. We will pass it with the help of some of the other senators out of the housing committee. And it is my hope to get the same bill passed in the assembly. Now, we will tell you that we work very closely with Assemblyman Castro, Assemblyman Rivera, Assemblyman Michael Benjamin, who is our other assembly person? Naomi Rivera. And so we will try to get all of the other assembly people to come on the bill and to get it out of the assembly. But from my end, within the next couple of weeks, we're going to seek to get it out of the Housing Committee, which I'm the chairman of.
Before the next question is asked, if anyone does have a question, again, I remind you to speak to Monica Coleman, so that way we can have the question. Thank you. You want to come up and say your name and ask the question?
Yo quiero saber qué pueden hacer acerca de la brutalidad policiaca y empleados que trabajan en la Housing Court, porque yo hablo español, a mi hija casi me la matan, a mí me partieron un brazo con esos abusos.
Well, just so I'd like to be clear, the question relates to
discrimination generally, in housing court specifically, where a criminal court, in housing court, and the issue of police brutality. And let me just say this. We were fortunate enough to develop a medical center and name it after our good friend Amadou Diallo, who was taken down in the worst example of police brutality and murder in recent memory here in the Bronx. We also know that we finally have real reports from the New York City Police Department, the Civilian Complaint Review Board's reports on a stop and frisk operation, which specifically profiles young black and Latinos for the most part. We are still working to pass state law off of what happened in the Amadou Diallo murder to really work to deal with that institutional bias and prejudice. But if you have a specific situation like in your situation, y le hablo directamente a usted, si usted tiene circunstancias que han afectado a usted personalmente, quiero que hable con el abogado de nuestras oficinas para ofrecerle servicio a usted. Generally speaking, you have a very specific issue. I know there's a general issue about police brutality in general, disrespect, as is applied to our community. Let us know immediately. Make sure you take a name, a badge number. We have people on our staff that work very closely with community relations and sit on every precinct council meeting. Right, Alex? And so we'll be able to follow through. But many times what we have is a general complaint, and it's very difficult to deal with that. So anytime you find yourself in a situation, it's the same thing with me. Take off the suit, you know, and boom, somebody tries to disrespect, abuse me or my family that has a badge. I jot down that badge number, I jot down that name, I jot down a description, and act on it immediately. That's what we ask of you. Come to our offices, and we will help you. We will assign legal counsel. We have three or four lawyers on staff, and when we can't deal with a situation, we find a referral to give you the appropriate legal resource. So thank you for sharing that. People, siga, please.
When the policeman came to Anthony Avenue, my son took it to his apartment because he don't know what to do. The boy was bleeding. The police came here, took my son, brought his chair, and beat my son up. They beat up my son. And they don't take his friend to the hospital. Another police brutality.
So now you know where you got to call, okay? Call our offices immediately. These are the kinds of situations that people feel they have to remain quiet. They get.
Please let us know right away, and the very next morning, if not that night, we'll be in touch with the precinct captain and be in touch with the head of the police force in this city, Mr. Kelly himself, I assure you.
Okay, like the senator said, just touch base with his office. Okay, we're almost at the end. I want to bring up Luella Hatch. Just give me a second.
You want to add something?
Quería dejarles saber, por favor, que el senador Pedro Espada tiene dos oficinas aquí en el Bronx y las puertas están abiertas para todos ustedes. Cualquier issue que tengan con relación, ya sea housing, educación, salud, cualquier issue, de cualquier forma que tengan, nuestras puertas están abiertas. Y mi nombre una vez más es María Rodríguez. Yo tengo mi carta conmigo. Puedo dársela y puedo recibirlo a cada uno de ustedes. No importa el issue, el problema que tengan, para eso estamos. Todos el staff del senador estamos dispuestos a ayudarlos a ustedes. Y la señora, sí, nosotros conocemos del caso de ella, la señora Carmen, ¿verdad? Y la estamos ayudando con uno de nuestros abogados. Y la continuaremos ayudando. Gracias.
Pero yo estoy preocupada por la educación, porque la escuela está cerca y quieren poner un centro de metadona. Y yo no estoy de acuerdo. Porque mi niño tiene que pasar cerca de ahí, de la escuela. Para ir a la escuela tienen que pasar por ahí. Yo creo que no deberían de poner un centro donde está la escuela cerca.
Vamos, antes que te vaya hoy, danos los detalles, la información. Like I see, our staff can look into it, and we can get in contact with the folks that are doing it and see what we can do. Okay? I know que tú tenías una pregunta también.
Sí, a mí me pasó algo parecido a lo que ellos.
Okay.
Pero fueron unos vecinos que se metieron a mi casa a darle golpe a mi hija. Mm. Ella cortó una de ellas. Son dos hombres y dos mujeres. Pero hay dos que no.
Si es nada más a la que mi hija cortó, pero ellos se metieron adentro de mi casa, no por el bobo, sino adentro de mi casa. Yo no sabía del pecho porque yo me estaba bañando. El 31 de diciembre. La gente salieron porque la mujer se tiró del piso por buena medida, se tiró del piso afuera. La policía llegó que fue mi hija que la llamó. Entonces por nosotros se lo llevaron presa.
Ok, lo que vamos a hacer, tenemos abogado aquí, pero
como yo dije al principio, si tenemos forms here to fill out, y we have staff people here, que ellos van a cogerle detalles, puede hablar también con María Rodríguez, que está por aquí, ella puede coger la información, y mañana mismo lo comunicamos para pasar por la oficina, sino mañana en viernes, para que empezamos el proceso, ¿ok? Está bien.
Ms. Luella Hatch, please.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
I want to thank the majority leader for being concerned about the youth,
seniors, housing, and whatever. But I'm also sitting here wondering, and I want to bring a point out to you. It's sad in Community Board 5 that we don't have a project sponsor. They are not willing to invest in our youth. That's why our youth are running crazy with gangs. They are selling drugs. They got guns. And everyone here know what I'm talking about. It's happening in every neighborhood. I live in the neighborhood opposite of the young lady there. But I know that somebody was hurt like 5 times. But together we can make a difference. We need to get together. Tenants, some of them don't know their rights. We need to stand up and be counted. And I'm saying to our majority leader, whatever you chose to do, we're going to be out there for you. And I can witness to y'all. I go to his office all the time. As he say, that's their job. Whatever I need to do, I really do it. And we are asking the senator, maybe what we need to do is bring these lenders who lends the landlord the money for the mortgage and they live out of town. We are fed up with that. That's wrong too. We need to go and work on DCHR. The young man was talking about the air conditioning. You hear, there's different ways they do with the air conditioning. And I'm going to tell you, if you don't study housing, you're not going to really know what housing is all about. So I just want to say to you, we love you. Whatever. When you out there fighting, we out there fighting too. So if you chose to go to his office, they will take care of you. And all of his staff is very nice. I go from Fordham to Bainbridge. Just don't be lazy. Tell us, get up and fight for your right. Angel, we're going to get people to help us with these youth. I may not see it, but we gotta go back like we used to do. Get jobs for these youth. They need our help. And you, parents, don't allow your kids. Tell your children to pull up those pants. They are disrespecting you, me, and everybody else. The name of the game is help yourself first. Thank you.
Okay, the next speaker, Aldo Karim. Rahim?
First, let me apologize for us being late. I'm a representative, assistant imam at Masjid Adam. We are definitely in support of the good that the senator is always bringing to us because it's important for us to understand. Just as the young lady spoke just now, one of the most important things any of us can ever do is get involved. All of us have to get involved. It is not on the senator himself, his staff, or anyone else, or I who speak or we go out and try to do things. No, it's on every individual who has come out. And because you are here, you are trying to make that statement. So we implore you, we ask you, we'll do anything. Master Adam is at 2236. We've been in touch with the senator's office on different things that we want to work with, definitely with the youth, definitely trying to bring in jobs. It is important to start to get the establishment to understand that the only thing that we truly need to do is make them remember that you don't get nothing without us. Our dollars is what's making you be able to live where you live at and do what you do. So you have to remember to return that back to us. And so, again, we're just here to be in support of all things good. That's what we're about, all things good. And I know that's what you're all about, so we thank you.
We have another event this evening that I want to get to. Tengo otro evento esta noche, pero primeramente y últimamente, como empecé, quiero sacar esto en oración y también darle las gracias a todos ustedes. I just want to end as we began, by ending in prayer, and have you know that I never, ever take your support for granted. I believe that I have to earn your support and respect each day, and I leave with that commitment that I will do so each and every day. I consider being your senator a privilege and an honor. Thank you very much.
If you want to stand or whatever's comfortable for you is best. With the name of God, the merciful benefactor, the merciful redeemer, we turn to He at this time, asking Him to bless us all with the hearts that will allow us to step forth and do the best for ourselves and our communities. We have to remember that turning to God is the best manner in which you will develop the heart that will take you to the best in life. We turn to God and ask Him to bless us, to bless the work of the senator, his staff, and to bless each and every one of us for wanting to come out and make that difference. The only way you can truly serve God is by serving humanity. When you improve humanity, you have served God. Amen.
Thank you so much for coming. Okay, if you have any questions, make sure you grab them at the end.